It's easy to imagine what an 1871 opera based on Mikhail Lermontov's The Demon ought to sound like. Lermontov's narrative poem is set in Georgia and subtitled Vostochnaya Povest, an Eastern story. The poem's many lyrical digressions on the Caucasus and its people would seem to give a composer not just the excuse, but practically the obligation to furnish a piquant smorgasbord of musical exotica. The Demon also features a supernatural anti-hero whose devilish exploits had earned his story a 20-year sojourn in the Russian censor's office. Here, too, did 19th-century opera provide clear precedents. A fantastic menace like Lermontov's title character all but demanded to be tricked out in harmonic novelty. Whole tones, in particular, were in perennial vogue among Russian opera's supernatural baddies, from Glinka's Chernomor to the statue from Alexander Dagromyshky's The Stone Guest. So we could be forgiven for expecting an operatic adaptation of The Demon to sound like a mashup of Rimsky-Korsakov and Borodin's greatest hits, to be overflowing with audacious harmonies, reedy timbres, and feats of outrageous melisma. That is exactly what critics did expect when they went to see Anton Rubinstein's adaptation of The Demon in 1875. The Eastern elements are in place, though confined to divertissement, choruses and dances, and the melismatic vocal lines of Prince Sinadal, the demon's unwitting romantic rival who does not manage to survive the only scene in which he appears. These Eastern numbers were widely and enthusiastically commented upon by contemporary critics, though later writers, at a disadvantage for having heard Prince Igor, have been less kind. But where was the supernatural in the work Rubinstein labeled a fantastic opera? César Cui, admittedly no friend to Rubinstein, could identify only one fleeting musical moment that fit the fantastic bill. The demon who sang on the stages of the Mariinsky, rang the critical consensus, was no demon at all, but an ordinary man. Oops, that's one too many. Some writers attributed the demon's apparent demotion to the singer, Ivan Melnikov. The bass, who one season earlier had made such an effective Boris Godunov, simply couldn't pull off the titanism of Lermontov's antihero. But Cui predictably pointed to a different problem. The Demon was written not in accordance with the demands of contemporary drama, but in old-fashioned forms. To wit, noted Cui, the opera's grand finale was, quote, composed from a variety of romances, which put the music into a coarsely absurd relationship to the scenario, end of quote. The plot called for high drama, and Rubinstein had supplied salon music. Cui's review of The Demon ended, appropriately perhaps, on a damning note. Quote, this opera is altogether ordinary and inspires little desire to see it a second time. Cui was wrong about that last part. The Demon quickly racked up over 100 stagings in both St. Petersburg and Moscow and was exported to Paris, London, Köln, and eventually New York. And this is a caricature of Rubinstein that appeared in London to accompany the 1881 premiere of Il Demonio. This opera was sung in Italian. You can see many of the more uncomfortable elements of Rubinstein's reception reflected here also. He's an eccentric foreigner with scales and horns who takes away English money. So, interesting historical artifact there. Yes, not only having composed Demonio, but having also made Demonio. Yes. All right. By any metric, The Demon was among the most successful Russian operas during the 19th century, though its subsequent fall from grace has paralleled Rubinstein's own. What interests me, however, is the first part of Cui's critique, his assertion that The Demon is, quote, altogether ordinary. In the most literal sense, he's right. The old-fashioned form that Cui finds in the finale to The Demon is that of the so-called Bytovoy Romance, a genre associated above all with amateur music making in Russian homes. So this is a genre of solo song with piano, usually piano or guitar accompaniment, popular among the Russian upper and middle classes in the 19th century. It's a sort of hybrid genre incorporating elements of both Russian folk and Western classical music. Bytovoy, the first word there, Bytovoy in this context is usually translated as domestic. But the word is generally used to refer to the stuff that surrounds us in our daily lives, the commonplace, the ordinary. A Bytovoy romance is both a song about ordinary life and a song performed mainly in ordinary life. not in concert halls and theaters. There are two issues I'd like to unpack here. One is the question of just what these ordinary songs are doing in a purportedly fantastic opera. In Yevgeny Onegin, written 2 years after the Demon's smashing premiere and clearly indebted to the earlier work, Tchaikovsky's use of the romance idiom is an eminently realistic device. The characters of Yevgeny Onegin sing, as it were, in their native musical language, the idiom of the music that surrounds them in their daily lives. Finding the same sort of realism in The Demon would take some serious interpretive gymnastics. Why would the devil's musical habitat sound like that of the 19th century Russian home? And what, for that matter, would a Georgian princess find so seductive about this particular musical accent? Beyond this, I'd like to think about the changing cultural status of the quotidian, the domestic, the ordinary, concepts that are all united in the Russian word buit. The fraught relationship between buit and individual subjectivity, and Rubinstein's depiction of that relationship in his popular opera, The Demon, is my topic today. Buit, the root of the adjective buitovoy, as in buitovoy romance, is famously untranslatable. An abstract noun relating to everyday material existence, buit has been most often positioned in contrast with buitie, spiritual or intellectual existence. So there's often a clear hierarchy here that spiritual and intellectual existence is better than the material world. Svetlana Boym, the most insightful modern theorist of buit, has demonstrated that this opposition is expressed most starkly in the work of early 20th century poets, such as Marina Tsvetaeva and Vladimir Mayakovsky. For these writers, everyday routines and domestic stuff, what we might call the daily grind, constitute a kind of hostile force, an impediment to the poet's creative eye, and thus the very opposite of real expression. As a successful commercial genre designed for domestic use, the buitovoy romance belongs to the sphere of buit rather than buitie. Mayakovsky's satirical poem Idol of 1928 puts the romance into a category of domestic commodities that includes porcelain elephants, playing cards, and gramophones. The buitovoy romance here is the theme music to bourgeois artificiality. And this is Mayakovsky's poem. The unusual spacing is original. So I'll read this in Russian so that you can hear the sort of Mickey Mouse rhyme scheme, and you can follow along in English. Samovar kipit со свистом, граммофон визжит романс. Два знакомых коммуниста подошли на преферанс. Пизы рококи, черви, масси, ритуал свершен сполна, смотрят с полочки на счастье три фарфоровых слона. And just for fun, here is a Soviet poster created in 1932 for International Women's Day that links buit with oppression and inanity. So we have our kitchen slave here in the lower left-hand corner being crushed by household stuff. We have a samovar, we have a teapot, a religious icon, we have some books that are probably not by Marx. Sentimental sheet music belongs in this pile too. The history of buit in the imperial period has been little studied, though the negative image of buit that we find in Mayakovsky and Tsvetaeva did have roots in the 19th century. Socialist critics of the 1850s and 1860s believed that Russian buit was in need of drastic and immediate transformation. Nikolai Chernyshevsky's infamous book, What Is to Be Done, of 1863, is perhaps less a novel than a didactic guide in how to make over one's ordinary private life in accordance with socialist principles. Whether or not a devoted revolutionary could even have such a thing as an ordinary private life was in fact a burning question in Russian literature of the 1860s. The most extreme writers, and I have Sergei Nishayev in mind here, answered in the negative. To be a revolutionary, one had to shun close interpersonal relationships, sentimentality, and the quotidian comforts of buit. Everyday rituals and domestic comforts were thus often construed in opposition to the well-being and the development of the socialist subject. As in so many areas of public discussion in Russia, the 1870s saw a softening of this rather sharply drawn contrast. The heroes of progressive literature of the 1870s, I'm thinking here of the work of Schiller Mikhailov and other even smaller fry, often managed to combine revolutionary ideology and ordinary pleasures. But the writer who accorded buit the highest status during this time was large fry indeed, Lev Tolstoy. It's difficult to deal briefly with an author who wrote thousands of pages about the irreducibility of human experience, but in the interest of time, I'm going to give it a shot. This is my sort of distillation of Tolstoy's views and writings from the 1860s and 1870s, so before the philosophical crisis that would prompt his confession of 1879-1880. So many writers in Russia, beginning with the literary critic Vissarion Belinsky in the 1840s, saw it as the task of literature to create vivid and recognizable social types. A writer needed to observe reality and create representative characters that were drawn ostensibly from life, but who were stripped of a real person's contradictions and extraneities. A social type, then, is a personality that's boiled down to its most basic and characteristic elements. Tolstoy does not buy this. In the second epilogue to War and Peace, he writes that we all want to see ourselves as discrete individuals. I am me and you are you. But Tolstoy writes that this belief in our own finitude is illusory, and that we should probably dispense with it. The border at which the individual meets the infinite is hazy, and perhaps even non-existent. And so Tolstoy's characters are always absorbing influences from the outside world, trying on and discarding social identities. Pierre in War and Peace is probably the most famous example of this, somebody who becomes a Freemason for a while, gives that up, decides he wants to murder Napoleon, gives that up. It goes through a whole bunch of different ideas and social identities throughout that novel. The Tolstoyan self is a moving target, not a fixed essence. And because we are moving targets, in Tolstoy it is not the case that the inner essence determines outer appearance and behavior. It's not the case of the subject acting on or transforming the environment. The influence goes the other way. Our habits, our possessions, our relationships, and our daily surroundings are constantly transforming us, conditioning our inner emotional responses for good or for ill. So to give one example, in Anna Karenina, Lyovin goes to Petersburg with Steve Oblonsky and gradually loses his moral compass. He begins to spend too much money. He drinks, and worst of all for Tolstoy, he is attracted to Anna, who is not his wife. And only when his environment is restored does he begin to resemble again the sort of idealistic country squire we've come to know. We also express our feelings, especially the most passionate ones, through conventions. So this is the tragedy of Anna, that she acts out in real life the conventions she's absorbed from the sentimental novels she reads. The most virtuous people are often the most prosaic ones. The most important events are those that appear the most ordinary and unremarkable. Tolstoy doesn't think much of people who claim to live for abstract ideas or romantic notions. Practical knowledge that is based on real, mundane experience is often portrayed as superior to more abstract forms of knowledge. In Anna Karenina, when Kitty and Lyovin go to visit Lyovin's dying brother, Lyovin is stupefied by the enormity of death, and Kitty immediately rushes to action. She sends for the doctor, she scrubs the room, she cleans the bed linens, and Lyovin marvels that for all of his education, he doesn't understand what life and death are as well as Kitty does. He thinks of these things as sublime, whereas she sees them as prosaic. Kitty's sister Dolly has the same kind of practical everyday knowledge of the world. So when Count Vronsky calls her excessivement terre à terre, excessively down to earth or excessively prosaic, we're supposed to see that comment as reflecting poorly on him, on his values, rather than on her character. By the same token, in War and Peace, Tolstoy writes that we ascribe too much importance to dramatic events. The most ordinary, unremarkable events, those that, in the Slavist Saul Morrison's words, are hidden in plain view, are those that shape us the most. And a person's mundane surroundings are not somehow opposed to that person's true selves, again, because the borders between self and environment are very fuzzy. We are what we surround ourselves with, for good or for ill, again. This armistice in the Russian intelligentsia's war against wheat would not hold. By the turn of the 20th century, the symbolists were once again rejecting the quotidian in favor of the utopian. Under Andrei Bely's quill, the term buitovik, which my Russian dictionary translates unhelpfully as writer on domestic themes, became a barbed pejorative. As Bely wrote in his memoirs, quote, "The banner that united us symbolists was the negation of that way of existence by which we were formed and the struggle against buit." During the 1870s, however, the negative effects of buit on Russians, both as individuals and as a society, were not universally assumed. Uncoincidentally, this period of détente was congruent with the high watermark of the realist movement in Russian art. The 15 years between 1866 and 1881 saw the debuts of a rather absurd number of realist monuments: Crime and Punishment, War and Peace, Boris Godunov, Anna Karenina, Evgeny Onegin, the Brothers Karamazov. And the most popular Russian opera of that period was Anton Rubinstein's The Demon. Realism in Russian literature is usually considered a big tent phenomenon, encompassing writers as diverse as Dostoevsky and Ostrovsky, Chernyshevsky and Tolstoy. Attempting to fix a definition on such a heterogeneous movement, like attempting to define realism in literature and especially music more generally, has proven a slippery enterprise. In her 2016 book on realism in 19th century Russian art, the Slavist and art historian Molly Brunson throws up her hands, suggesting that we see, quote, the many manifestations of Russian realism as united not by how they look or by what they describe. What Russian artists in the age of realism had in common was rather a shared awareness for the fraught yet critical task of representation, end of quote. In those broad terms, one is tempted to ask what artist of any time or place has not been a realist. In musicology, on the other hand, we have tended to understand Russian realism as the exclusive preserve of avant-gardists like Mussorgsky or Dagomyshky, composers whose awareness of the fraught yet critical task of representation led to bold experiments in harmony and form. Only recently have scholars begun to apply the R word, realism, even to Tchaikovsky's Evgeny Onegin, a work that implies Karl Dahlhaus's criteria of the musical novel from realism and 19th century music, as well as any opera by Charpentier. Anton Rubinstein's The Demon would seem a particularly inauspicious place to look for realism of any sort, having after all been labeled by its composer a fantastic opera. But in its way, The Demon is also an idiosyncratic experiment in representation. Cui was not the only critic to point out the opera's peculiar use of the Vidovoy romance, for example. And the way in which that opera represents the real, I want to argue, has something in common with Tolstoy's contemporary novels. Both the author of War and Peace and the composer of the Ocean Symphony locate the real in the everyday, not the extraordinary. As The Demon is not exactly a repertoire standard anywhere outside of Russia, a bit of plot summary is probably not out of place here. Written in dialogue with early 19th century European literature, Lermontov's original poem is among the most romantic of all Russian artworks. Many critics have found in it elements of Faust, Paradise Lost, and the various Promethei of English Romanticism. I'd throw in Blake's Marriage of Heaven and Hell as well. The hero of Lermontov's poem is an arrogant but ultimately sympathetic figure who rebels against the austere lawfulness of heaven. Flying melancholically over the Caucasus one day, he falls in love with a Georgian princess, Tamara, and begins his pursuit rather inauspiciously by murdering her fiancé. Tamara withdraws to a monastery, and the demon follows forthwith. After dispatching her angel guardian, he resumes his seduction, vowing, how sincerely it's hard to say, to give up evil out of love for her. Tamara assents, but the demon's kiss proves fatal. She is saved by her suffering, and the demon is left alone and more miserable than ever. Lermontov's antihero is indeed a titan, one of Russian literature's few exemplars of the romantic genius. His power is unearthly, and his motives often obscure. He is to be marveled at, not identified with. Opera has a way of inflating the life-sized into the grandiose, but Rubinstein's adaptation of The Demon did the opposite to Lermontov's title character. The original poem had been short on direct speech that could be incorporated directly into the libretto, and so the librettist Pavel Viskovatov had to be inventive, filling in some of the psychological details that Lermontov's poem had left ambiguous. At the outset of the poem, the demon is a rebel without a cause, a bored and jaded bad boy who can't abide by heaven's rules. His feelings are dulled. When the demon sees the sublime beauty of the Caucasus, Lermontov writes, on his lofty brow, nothing registered. In the prologue to the opera, however, Rubinstein and Viskovatov shift the focus from what the demon doesn't feel to what he does feel, or even more specifically, what he wants to feel. The baritone demon is an emotional being for whom timeless, static bliss seems a torment. He wants to be human, not immortal. And his rebellion is not simply born of boredom. It stems from his desire to experience all human feelings, not just the tranquil ones. What is the radiance of eternal power to me, the demon asks his angelic interlocutor. What is holy paradise? I want freedom and passion, not peace. Musically speaking, this prologue is a direct answer to Tchaikovsky's The Maid of Orleans, which also sets lawful heaven against the chaos of strong emotions. In both operas, unfeeling angels can offer only triads and regularity, while the passionate protagonists favor chromaticism, minor keys, and erratic phrasing. The opera, too, adds depth to the demon's infatuation with Tamara. It is not only her beauty that attracts him, as it is in Lermontov. Spying her among a group of her girlfriends, he muses, yes, like them she is beautiful, but not passionless, like they are. Feeling, once again, is what the demon seeks, and feeling is what distinguishes the two leading characters from all the others. The libretto surrounds both the demon and Tomato with cold, passionless foils. The girls in Tomato's case and the angel in the demon's, identifying these two as the only warm-blooded creatures in an opera full of emotional reptiles. Throughout, where Lermontov's demon and Tamara had been sketchy, Rubinstein and Viskovatov fleshed them out, giving the two leading characters complex feelings that are aired at far greater length in the opera than in the poem. The demon and Tamara are also the only two characters who sing romances. After encountering Tamara, the demon will no more embody musical chaos. From here forward, he and Tamara will communicate through the idiom of the Buitovoi romance. This incursion of the musical ordinary occurs quite paradoxically at some of the least ordinary moments of the plot. As the crowd reels from the news that Tamara's fiancé has been killed on the eve of their wedding, the demon, offstage and unseen, sings a Buitovoi romance that is audible to Tamara alone. Later, the seduction duet that comprises almost the whole of Act III is, as Cui pointed out, a veritable romance-a-thon. And here, the demon uses ordinary songs to tell Tamara that she should love him precisely because he is not ordinary. I am the king of knowledge and freedom, he boasts, the enemy of heaven. And look, I am at your feet. I have brought you a prayer of purest love. Even while exercising his supernatural powers, the demon is musically domesticated. He narrates his passion and his power in the highly conventional form of the Buitovoi romance. And just so that you can have this in your ears, I'm going to play you the first part of this 25-minute duet, which this first part is actually a solo romance for the demon. It's a self-contained song in C-sharp minor, ABA form with a coda. These are the first two lines here. You can see the typical song-like accompaniment and the arched four-bar phrases. The first half of these phrases, going from the first note after the pickup down to the E there, describes the interval of a descending sixth, which is a feature that almost defines the genre of the Buitovoi romance. This phrase is being built on the interval of a sixth. Also, the first parts of those phrases sit on a knife edge between the tonic minor and the relative major there. As soon as we get the tonic chord, we have natural seven up there in the voice, and we have the relative major chord. This is a feature that is also quite common in Russian folk music. And then at the end of the phrase, Rubinstein raises the seventh scale degree and gives us the dominant chord. So all of these elements are very characteristic of the Buitovoi romance, which is a stylized form of folk music written for an urban audience. These songs generally incorporate some of the melodic elements of folk music, but standardize the phrasing and add functional harmony. You can also tell, incidentally, that Lermontov's text was not meant to be set this way, because the rhyme scheme in the two A sections is different. And in fact, the first A section here contains a line that doesn't rhyme with the rest. So Rubinstein has kind of shoehorned Lermontov's text into this form of the Buitovoi romance. So I'm just going to play you the first little bit of this so you can hear it. This is Dmitry Khorostovsky in a 2015 concert production in Moscow. And so on and so forth. Close your eyes, and the entire duet that follows could have been excerpted from a real-life domestic scene. The hero and the heroine take turns singing romances, their voices rarely mingling. Russian literature of the time offers several examples of piano-side courtships, Oblomov, most famously, or Dmitry Mamim Sibiryak's novel, The Prevalov Fortune of 1883, which contains a scene of seduction via Buitevoy romance. Our cozy domestic scene here, however, is set in a monastery cell and enacted by the devil and a Caucasian princess who hears voices in her head. This disjunction was precisely what drove Cui mad about the demon. He found in it all the faults of the conservatory, arguing that the opera showed, quote, a great familiarity with old music and none whatsoever with contemporary movements and dramatic music, end of quote. Realism was expected of Russian artworks at the time, and the demon is not realistic in any way Cui would recognize, and maybe not even in any way Tchaikovsky would recognize either. The music, after all, seems to have little to do with the characters. What it does have to do with, however, is the audience. The music of the demon refers not to the social reality of the characters, but that of the audience. The opera positions Tamara and the demon as the two characters who have real feelings, and has them express those feelings through music that Rubinstein's 19th century Russian audience could recognize as coming from real life. Richard Stites and most recently Julia Mannhertz have written about the importance of domestic musical performance in the emotional lives of 19th century Russians, especially in the romantic arena. Stites notes, quote, like the ball, home performance was a well-established practice of chaste interaction among the sexes, the compliments and blushes being as much a part of the performance as the movement of the hands and the vocal cords. This state of affairs was not exclusive to Russia, of course, but in Russia, the Buitevoy romance was the main genre through which these musical interactions occurred, and that association, that familiarity, might help to account for why the demon never really succeeded as an export item, despite its enormous popularity at home. Describing Il Demonio's poor reviews in the London press, Rubinstein's British biographer posited, quote, it needed Russian listeners, credulous as children, who could accept a demon lover on the stage, end of quote. Maybe not all of this is nonsense, though I'm sure we can think of many sillier things that Western opera audiences have accepted. A magical golden helmet that can change a giant into a dragon comes to mind. For perhaps the demon did need Russian listeners, who lived their daily lives to the soundtrack of the Buitevoy romance, the ordinary genre that in Rubinstein's most popular Russian opera comes to serve as the language of authentic feeling. I'm already over time, so I'm going to skip the next two paragraphs where I talk about productions of this opera during during the Silver Age and how the symbolists attempted to sort of remystify Rubinstein's domestic demon. But ask me during the question time if you're interested. I have some pictures. It seems only fair to give the penultimate word to Tolstoy, the writer who treated the ordinary with such extraordinary respect. In What is Art? Tolstoy argues that what separates good art from bad is social function. Good art unites, bad art divides, and so for art to be good, it has to be above all accessible. 20 years earlier, discussing the demon, the music critic Laroche had described Rubinstein in proto-Tolstoyan terms. Quote, Rubinstein addresses himself to the masses, speaking in terms that are simple and understandable, and meets with a sympathetic response. End of quote. The word sympathetic seems to get Rubinstein's procedures in the demon just about right, I think. That opera is one of Rubinstein's most sympathetic creations, connecting the feeling beings on both sides of the auditorium through the ordinary language of domestic song. Thank you.